On the night of the 21st-22nd of January, 1879, 140 British soldiers successfully defended the mission station at Rorke's Drift against 4,000 Zulus during the Anglo-Zulu War in South Africa. It's celebrated as one of the most heroic stands in British Army history. 11 Victoria Crosses were awarded to the defenders, and it became immortalised in the classic war film Zulu. And that film preserves not just their bravery, but the names of some of those Rorke's Drift heroes: Bromhead, Chard, Henry Hook VC, Fred Hitch VC, Surgeon Reynolds, Colour Sergeant Bourne, to name just a few. And yet, there is one giant of a man whom the film and indeed history have almost forgotten. A huge 6'6", 18 stone army chaplain who spent the whole battle distributing ammunition, encouraging the men with biblical quotes, and telling them off for swearing. This is the story of Chaplain George Smith, known to the defenders of Rorke's Drift as Ammunition Smith. The Reverend George Smith was born on the 8th of January, 1845, in the village of Docking in Norfolk. By an interesting quirk, for those of you who've seen the film Zulu, you might recall that both the introduction and ending of the film were narrated by Richard Burton. Well, whilst awaiting for D-Mob from the RAF, Burton was actually accommodated at Docking Hall in this village. George Smith was the youngest of three sons of master shoemaker William Smith and his wife Frances. Details of his early life are sketchy, but by the time of the 1861 census, he was recorded as being employed as a railway clerk, living in the nearby big town of King's Lynn. Nor do we know how he met his religious calling, but in 1870, he arrived in South Africa as a missionary, employed by the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel. 2 years later, he was ordained by the Anglican Archbishop of Natal, John Colenso, and became the incumbent at East Court in the British colony of Natal. As relations between Britain and the Kingdom of the Zulus descended towards war, Colenso was a passionate advocate for peace and was regarded by many colonists, as well as the military commander, Lord Chelmsford, as definitely pro-Zulu. George Smith didn't share the same views as his archbishop and volunteered his services to Lord Chelmsford as he prepared for his invasion, joining the Central Column as an assistant army chaplain. The Royal Army Chaplains Department had been established in the 1790s with the aim of providing pastoral support to all soldiers, regardless of their religious beliefs, or none at all, as well as providing moral guidance and, of course, spiritual guidance too. So this role as an assistant chaplain was a perfect fit given Smith's current role in Natal. I've produced videos on the British invasion, their defeat at the Battle of Isandlwana, and the defence of Rorke's Drift in other videos, so I'm not going to go into depth on those actions here. Tensions have been mounting between the British and the Zulus for some time, and for a variety of reasons, the British authorities on the ground in South Africa, the High Commissioner, Sir Bartle Frere, and the Army Commander, Lord Chelmsford, decided to contrive a war. A war, by the way, that they had been specifically told to avoid by British Prime Minister Benjamin Disraeli. An ultimatum was issued to the Zulus, which, as intended, the Zulu King Keshweyo would not or could not meet. And so, on the 11th of January 1879, the British invaded, Chelmsford leading the largest of three attacking columns across the border at Rorke's Drift. The morning of the 21st of January 1879 found Reverend Smith at the mission station at Rorke's Drift. He had no specific role at the station, which was acting as a supply depot for Chelmsford's army already inside Zululand. In fact, he was awaiting orders to proceed to the British camp at Isandlwana. To say that Smith had a presence would be an understatement. In an age when the height of the average British soldier was around 5'6", he stood at a towering 6'6", still tall by today's standards, and he weighed in at 18 stone. He also sported a huge red beard that flowed down to his waist. Smith was actually one of two clergymen at Rorke's Drift that morning, the other being the Swedish missionary whose station Rorke's Drift was, Otto Witt. Contrary to the film Zulu, Witt was not visiting Keshweyo's Zulu capital with his daughter that morning. In fact, his daughter was merely an infant, and Witt had packed her off with his wife and other children further into the colony for safety. Nor, unlike his character in the film, played by Jack Hawkins, was he a defender of the Zulus. In fact, he was very enthusiastic about the British invasion, as it would give him the opportunity to add to his flock, a goal that King Keshweyo was utterly opposed to. During the morning, the garrison at Rorke's Drift could hear the distant crackle of gunfire from Isandlwana, but were unaware of what was going on. Surgeon Reynolds, together with Army Chaplain George Smith and the Swedish missionary Otto Witt, ascended the hill behind Rorke's Drift in an unsuccessful effort to get a better view. The African haze and the rolling landscape hid the battle from the three men. If they had been able to observe the camp less than 10 miles away, they would have seen an army of 20,000 Zulus attacking the British camp at the foot of the hill. That morning, Lord Chelmsford had divided his column and had headed eastwards, deeper into Zululand, to engage the Zulu army that he believed was heading towards him. Unbeknown to him, that army had actually moved to his north, and it now launched a full-scale attack on the remainder of his force still at the camp at Isandlwana. Now, it's a fascinating battle, and as I said earlier, I've produced a video all about it, so I'm not going to go into details now. Suffice to say that despite gallant resistance, the British were wiped out almost to a man. Hardly any white soldiers escaped, and those who did were on horseback. At around 3:30 p.m, the men up on the hill suddenly saw riders galloping towards the mission station. Surgeon Reynolds went down to see if they needed any medical assistance, leaving the two clergymen still up on the hill. After a short while, they observed a large number of Africans advancing towards the mission station, but initially they thought they were members of the Natal native contingent, local blacks who were fighting for the British. It was only as they started to identify regimental shields that they came to the horrifying realisation that the men advancing were not friends, but an army of 4,000 Zulu warriors, who'd formed the reserve at Isandlwana and had now crossed the border, contrary to their king's orders, to plunder outlying farms, and were now bent on plundering the British supply base at Rorke's Drift. Chaplain Smith and the missionary Otto Witt hightailed it down the hill and rushed into the camp to break their news, only to find that thanks to the other fugitives, the officers there were aware of the imminent attack and were already throwing up a hasty barricade using biscuit boxes and mealie bags in an attempt to fortify the mission station. Otto Witt, contrary to the film, Zulu did not get drunk, but instead grabbed a horse and set off to find his family. And you can hardly blame him. As a civilian missionary, he would have been little to no use in the forthcoming battle. In fact, the same thought seems to have crossed Chaplain George Smith's mind too. He too was a man of God, and was merely, as an assistant chaplain, a civilian. When, however, he went to look for his horse, he found it missing, along with his groom. Now, whether he liked it or not, George Smith was going to be in the Battle of Rorke's Drift, and a legend was born. A legend that very few people remember. The attack on Rorke's Drift began about an hour after Smith and co. had seen the horsemen galloping towards the mission station. The Battle of Rorke's Drift lasted 12 hours throughout the night as the British garrison, numbering about 140 men, held off wave after wave of the 4,000 Zulu army. The defenders were mainly from B Company of the 24th Regiment of Foot, the Warwickshires, who would later become the South Wales Borderers. But there were men from other regiments there too, such as Surgeon Reynolds from the Army Medical Corps, James Langley Dalton of the Army Commissariat, Corporal Sheese of the Natal Mounted Police, and of course the officer commanding, the Royal Engineer, Lieutenant John Chard. And all of these men would receive the Victoria Cross. And then there was George Smith. With no option other than to stay, he grabbed a satchel or haversack and stuffed it full of ammunition. And throughout that frightening night, as some of the men, such as Private Henry Hook, dug their way from room to room in the burning hospital, Smith moved around the defences, handing out ammunition from his satchel. His huge frame, his flowing red beard, his black robes gave him an almost Old Testament prophet look. And with the build and strength of a heavyweight boxer, he was even seen carrying whole ammunition boxes towards the barricades by himself. All the time exhorting the British troops with biblical phrases. And as the night wore on, the terror and nerves of the soldiers were relieved by more and more expletives being uttered by them. And in true British Army chaplain fashion, Smith reprimanded his flock, shouting, "Don't swear, men, don't swear! But shoot them, boys, shoot them!" At one stage, his shouts of "don't swear, but aim low" were countered by an unknown defender who shouted back through the din of the battle, "You do the praying, Padre, I'll just shoot the beeps!" He earned himself a nickname from the defenders at the battle. Ammunition Smith. If you enjoy my videos, then why not join my supporters club for even more videos, many of which are exclusive and not available on YouTube, such as the Battle of Cable Street and the story of the original Royal Oak. I'll share a link at the end, plus there'll be a link in the description below. In fact, actually, there's one coming up now. As dawn rose on the 22nd of January, the defenders looked out from their tiny fortification. faces black from gun smoke, throats parched dry, the stench of burnt thatch and burned bodies from the hospital, bodies of dead Zulus strewn around the perimeter. Once more, the Zulus seem to be massing for another charge. The defenders have spent most of the 20,000 rounds of ammunition that had been left at the supply base, many of which had been handed out to them by Smith. Maybe one more concerted Zulu attack would have broken through, but it never came. These Zulus, many in their 40s, hadn't eaten for over 24 hours. They'd run to the Battle of Isandlwana and then run a further 10 miles to Rorke's Drift and had fought all the way through the night. They'd suffered over 400 of their comrades killed, countless more injured. They were spent. Furthermore, disturbing reports were reaching them that British soldiers were marching from Zululand towards them. There was no singing of a salute to fellow brave warriors as in the film Zulu. They simply turned and wearily marched back towards home. The British army that they had heard was marching towards them was in fact Chelmsford's force that hadn't been at Isandlwana. Hearing that the Zulu army was behind him, they had marched back to the camp and had spent an uncomfortable night lying amongst the dead. And before first light, Chelmsford had ordered them to break camp so as to prevent his troops seeing the grisly carnage from the annihilation of their comrades the day before. An advance guard of cavalry had crossed the Buffalo River down at the actual drift and rode warily towards what remained of the mission station at Rorke's Drift. And as they saw a Union flag still flying, they broke out into cheers, which was taken up all along Chelmsford's column. The defenders had lost 17 dead and 10 wounded. The Zulus, who had outnumbered them 40-1, had lost at least 400 men. It remains one of the most heroic stands in British Army history. 11 Victoria Crosses were awarded to the defenders, and the events were captured in the classic 1960s film Zulu. It's one of my favourite war films, even though many of the events have been altered to create a film story. Some of the events in the film were fabricated, and some events that actually happened were omitted. And possibly the greatest omission of all is that of Chaplain George Smith, who makes not a single appearance in the film. He's not even referred to, which is a real shame because his courage and service as a civilian would offer a different angle to the story. Certainly, his fellow defenders recognised his contributions. Apart from the nickname Ammunition Smith, an officer with Chelmsford's relief column, Captain Henry Harford, recorded that whenever either Ammunition Smith or indeed Acting Commissary Dalton appeared amongst the survivors, a loud cheer would go up. He believed that both men deserved Britain's highest medal for valour, the Victoria Cross. James Langley Dalton was indeed one of the 11 defenders at Rorke's Drift to be awarded the VC. Alas, Padre George Smith wasn't. His omission was due to a technicality rather than because people didn't think he had performed with great valour. As an assistant chaplain, he was classed as a civilian, and the VC was not an award open to civilians. If Smith had been a full-time soldier, a full-time chaplain, he possibly would have been the chaplaincy's first ever VC winner. As it was, that honour fell to James William Adams later that year for bravery during the Second Anglo-Afghan War. In lieu of a medal for his services, George Smith was instead offered a full-time appointment as an army chaplain, which he willingly accepted. Within a few days, he'd be called upon to conduct the burial services of Lieutenants Coghill and Melvill, who had died trying to carry the Queen's colours of the 1st Battalion, 24th Foot, to safety from Isandlwana. They had died on the banks of the Buffalo River, and their bodies were discovered on the 3rd of February. The following day, Chaplain Smith conducted the funeral services as they were buried where they'd fallen, and their graves, looking down on the Fugitives' Drift at the Buffalo River, remain there to this day. And again, I've produced a video about Melvill and Coghill and will include a link in the description below. Chaplain George Smith was to serve as an army padre for the next 25 years. His military service would take him for 5 years to Egypt, where he was present at the Battle of Tel el-Kebir and in the attempt to relieve General Charles Gordon at Khartoum. For his actions at Tel el-Kebir, he was awarded the Queen's Medal for Egypt and the Khedive of Egypt's Bronze Star. In 1885, he was at the Battle of Guinness, where a joint British and Egyptian Sudanese force under General Francis Grenfell defeated the Sudanese Mahdists. A battle which is hardly known about today, but it was the last time that British soldiers en masse fought wearing red coats. It was also the battle where the sergeants of the Durham Light Infantry adopted a 2-year-old Sudanese boy whose father had been killed and whose mother had fled. And that boy was ultimately to follow the regiment back to the northeast of England, where he grew up in the community there, married a local white woman, and became the first black man to enlist in the regular British Army as opposed to colonial units like the Natal Native Contingent. The story of Private James Durham is one I'd like to share with you in the future, and maybe you'd like me to share that too. The British commander at the Battle of Guinness, General Grenfell, would have a road in West London named after him, which in the 1960s lent its name to a nearby tower block under construction, Grenfell Towers. And that was the site of a tragic fire in 2017. It's interesting how historical events, you know, from the past link to the present. In the latter part of his career, Padre Smith served at Aldershot and at the Royal Victoria Hospital at Netley near Southampton. This vast hospital complex built during the Crimean War was not far from Queen Victoria's residence on the Isle of Wight, Osborne House, resulting in many injured soldiers receiving awards such as the Victoria Cross from the Queen herself whilst convalescing at the hospital. Case in point was George Smith's fellow Rorke Strift defender, Private Fred Hitch, VC. During World War I, the hospital treated over 50,000 patients and a further 68,000 during World War II, before being demolished in the 1960s. George Smith was to rise to the rank of Chaplain of Forces, First Class, which is the equivalent in rank to a colonel. In 1899, he became chaplain at Fulbrook Barracks near Preston in Lancashire, and he remained there until he retired in 1905, at the age of 60. He made Preston his home, although in retirement he offered travel to sunnier climates, such as the United States, the Panama Canal, and Australia. His arrival in Australia in 1912-1913, despite being over 30 years after the events at Rorke's Drift, created quite a media stir, with crowds coming out to welcome him wherever he went. Padre George Smith, who never married, passed away during the night of 26th-27th November 1918 from bronchitis. He was 73. He was buried with full military honours at Newhall Lane Cemetery, Preston. And on his grave was placed a wreath from the South Wales Borderers Regiment. It simply read, "In memory of Rorke's Drift." A hero almost forgotten, and wrongly forgotten, except to Zulu war buffs, and now to you too. Chaplain George Smith, of the Battle of Rorke's Drift. Ammunition Smith. What a man. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed that video and found the story interesting. Don't forget to give me a like, and how about joining my History Chap Supporters Club? What's that all about? Well, click on the link that's going to appear in a moment. Loads more videos coming your way, but in the meantime, keep well, and I'll see you very soon.